Hi, in today's video, I'm going to show you how to include custom indicators in your reinforcement learning model when it comes to trading stocks with machine learning. If you haven't seen my first video, I'll link it somewhere in these corners here and you can check it out. But let's go ahead and jump in and get to the interesting bit. So first little bit you need to do is use stable baselines 3. We're going to import a bunch of packages here, and then we'll need to source the data. We're going to do a time series intraday using the Alpha Vantage API. For the symbol, let's go ahead and take a look at Apple, and we're going to put that into a data frame. The thing we need to do is take this column here and make it the index. So that's what this kernel does, or this cell does. We're going to sort the values. In my first video, I made the mistake of just passing through the data without sorting it, and so it was actually reading it backwards. So we want it to go from its earliest time, and we want it to ascend. So this is in 5-minute increments. So it's going from 4:05 to 4:10 to 4:15 to 4:20 for this date. So that's one thing that we optimized, is we're actually passing through the data correctly. We're not starting from the earliest row going to the past. We're starting from the past and moving forward. The other thing that we're doing is we're getting our output size to be full this time. So in the previous video, I only passed in 100 rows of data, and which is about 500 minutes, I think. So in this, what we're doing is we're actually getting 3,390 rows of data. So much, much, much more. And we also need to turn these column names into capitalizations. So let's rename those. And that's just because when we pass it through our any trading environment, it needs to be in capitalization, so the package knows what data we're passing through. We also just need to make sure that the volume is a integer. This doesn't matter with Alpha Vantage, but if you're sourcing your financial data from somewhere else, like a CSV from Yahoo or something, it's most likely going to return your volume data as an object. So just be sure to check your types and turn it into an integer or a float. So now we're going to get to the custom integers portion. We're going to use the Finta package. So install Finta and then bring in any trading, import stocks environment, Finta with technical indicators. So for my technical indicators, I want to use Bollinger Bands. The Bollinger Bands will return a new data frame. And you can see here that it just is a bunch of zeros, but I'll show you later that, in fact, what we're doing is because we've set the time element to 14, we won't see any values for 14 more rows. And instead of having NAs come here, we're just going to fill it with zeros. So that's what this cell is doing here. And then we want to include the RSI and the VWAP to our current data frame up here. And then we're gonna merge them together and fill in everything with zero. So let's go ahead and create those columns, check out our head, and you can see RSI and VWAP have now been included into our data frame. So we need to merge them, and we're gonna just do an inner merge with on timestamp, and let's go ahead and take a look at our data. So like I said, because the Bollinger Bands have a distance of 14, we don't see that until we've reached the 14th row, and it's not going to calculate any Bollinger Bands because it needs these 14 cells here to calculate where these Bollinger Bands are going to be. So this is what our data is going to look like. This is what we're going to pass through our environment. Before, all we were passing through in our first video was the high, open, low, close volume. And the indicator that the default indicator that the environment uses is the price and the price movement up and down. So this is going to give it a lot. This is going to give our agent a lot more technical indicators to use in order to determine whether or not it should buy or sell. In order to do that, however, we need to create a function that will take our data and use it in the stead of its default. Might not make sense unless I show you. So we're going to create a function called signals that's going to take our environment. It's going to start from the, you know, the first frame and the last frame minus the window size. And if you remember in our previous video, the window size is any amount of data that our agent can see at any given time. So we're going to pass in a lot of data, but the agent only has a certain window to explore that data and make decisions based on. So we're just going to create variables, assign variables called start and end, which is going to be just the start and the end of our data frame here. We're going to pass in through our prices, which is a data frame location of low. It's all the rows, including low here. I don't know if I like low. So I think what I'm going to do instead, because I wasn't getting the greatest results, so I don't know if this is a good idea. I don't know if this makes any sense, but let's try close this time instead of low, just because I wasn't getting the kind of results that I was looking for. So let's actually reinitialize that function. And then here we've assigned a variable called signal features, which is, again, our data frame, including the close, volume, RSI, VWAP, upper Bollinger Bands and lower Bollinger Bands. Don't really care about the middle. I just want the agent to see when the bars pass the Bollinger Bands and see if it can decide whether or not, if it can build a strategy on whether or not it should buy or sell from there. The next thing we need to do is create a class that takes our stocks environment. And typically, the default, basically what we're doing with this signals features is we're replacing the default signals feature within the stocks environment. So we're just building a class. We're saying instead of using your default, use this function instead, which we've just created with all of our data. And then we're creating a second environment that includes my custom environment, which then takes the information of our data frame, our window size, which is going to be 10, and our frame bound, which is going to be 10 through rows 2,917, which I think is about 80% of our data frame here. So let's initialize this variable. And then this commented out cells was from the first video, but it was basically making sure that our environment worked and that if we took random actions to see whether or not our environment worked, basically. So because we know it works and because we've created this custom environment, we're going to skip over this and just go straight to training our model. Typically right here, what we would have is our first environment, but we're just going to change it to our environment two. And then we're going to create a dummy vector for that. And then we're going to pass it through our model. So let's initialize the environment maker and the environment. We're going to pass through our model, an A2C model. We're going to stick with A2C because I was doing some research and A2C seems to be the right model to use. I will in the future make a video comparing the metrics of the PPO and the DQN models. But for now, we're just going to stick with the A2C. Environment and verbose one, total time steps. Looks like I'm doing 1 million here. I don't think I need 1 million, but I haven't really figured out a place to where our explained variance gets to a good spot. So we're just going to go ahead and keep it at 1 million. And it shouldn't take too long, but let's cut it here, and then I'll see you when it's all done. So it's finished. Okay, cool. So we're back, and then it's finished training. It's finished learning. I still got to figure out like the best way to do this because I'm still not getting the best results. And based on the guides that I've seen, I should be getting better. So we're going to keep tinkering around, but for right now, this is sort of our explained variance. Like, that's not what I want. We want this to be as close to one as possible. And this is at -1. This is at -4, 104, negative 113. So we really need that callback function to save the best, loss function. But that's probably for part 3. So let's move on and see how well this works anyway. So you may have recognized this before. This is in our earlier video where we're resetting the environment and we're passing through, instead of our training data, this is our validation data here, and our testing data, however you want to look at it. Window size is going to remain the same. We're just going to be pulling from our data. And let's go ahead and run. Looks like what did I do wrong? OBS is not defined because I forgot to run that. Here we go. And it looks like we more or less broke even. And I'll explain what I mean by that. Basically, what we're looking at is if this is above 1, we've made a profit. If it's 0 point something something, we've lost money. So the fact that it's above by ten thousandths of a place there means that we've made money. But you can see it's pretty much bought at every point within our trading environment here. So I don't necessarily see how we could have made money. So like, we bought here when probably we should have sold. I don't know. I guess it's just assuming that it's always going to go up. So this isn't the best results, I think. Let's bring it back even farther. So if I look at, so we went to 2917. Okay. And we're going up to 3000. Let's just go through the whole data set and see where it lands. So if I remember correctly, 3390. Get anything else? So yeah, we're zoomed out quite a bit more. So if you recall, we were sort of just looking at this part of the data here at the end. But it looks like Apple's stock just sort of like flatlined. Oh, it's probably because this is the most recent data and it's just the weekend. It's actually MLK weekend when I'm recording this video. So this portion here is probably just the market closing. So it's buying. Okay, that's silly of me. I shouldn't have done that. But that shouldn't make too big of a difference anyway. You can see that we've lost money in the whole shebang when we add on the other 300 rows there. And it's also included all of this here too, even though we didn't change the beginning. Not really, that's interesting. But we've added our technical indicators. It's performing better than what we were doing just with the simple up and down indicator, the default indicator. And we've also been able to import a larger data set into it. I'm going to tinker around, play with different stocks and see if I can do anything else. The other thing it has is like a forex environment that we could try. But for now, I think what I need to focus on is creating the callback function, creating like a way to measure its performance without it being trained, and then from it being trained, I think would be helpful to see if the training is actually doing anything positive. So getting in some metrics and then also bringing in some quant stats to evaluate the performance better, because I don't know what the Sharpe ratio is here. I don't know. There's a lot more information that I could get out of this. So I think I'm going to include that for part 3 as well. So hopefully this helped you. The main point of the video was to show you how to add in these technical indicators. And I really should maybe just try different technical indicators. So you could see here, I used to have a simple moving average. I might bring that back, and I used to have OBV as well. But I wanted to use VWAP and Bollinger Bands because I've used those indicators in previous videos about algorithmic trading. So I might switch up the indicators too to see if I can actually get an agent to be giving us some really decent returns, some exciting returns. But it's all part of the process. I'll see you in the next video. Hope you enjoyed it, and bye.